Good morning, class. Once again, we are back with our chapter number 6, Colonialism and the City. We have already seen that how Delhi became the capital, what were the measures that were taken, how Delhi was being made. Even those two architects have planned for this new capital entirely. We have already seen this, how this planning of new capital came into existence and the entire region. We have already covered all these things here. Yes. Now let's begin with the life in the time of partition. So after this Delhi was being made as the new capital of our country, what happens in the life at the time when India got independence or when India was divided into two parts? Let's see the life in the prime of partition. The partition of India in 1947 led to a very massive transfer of populations on both the sides of the new border. You all know this. From both the sides, even from India and even from Pakistan, people have shifted to a larger extent. So as a result, the population of Delhi swelled up. The population of Delhi increased, that means. The kinds of the jobs did change and the culture of the city became different. So the days after Indian independence and partition, fierce rioting began. Thousands of people in Delhi were killed and their homes were looted and burned. As streams of Muslims left Delhi for Pakistan, their place was taken by equally large numbers of Sikhs and Hindu refugees. So the Muslim people, when they left for Pakistan, their houses were being taken over by Delhi's Sikh and Hindu refugees from Pakistan. Refugees roamed the streets of Shahjahanabad searching for empty homes to occupy. At times they forced Muslims to leave or sell their properties. Over 2/3 of the Delhi Muslims migrated. Almost 44,000 homes were abandoned. Terrorized Muslims lived in the makeshift camps till they could leave for Pakistan. So this was such the very terrifying condition of Delhi at the time. Muslims were being left, Hindus and Sikhs were capturing their properties, and everywhere people killing each other, riots were there, such bad condition. So at the same time, Delhi became a city of refugees. Nearly 5 lakh people were added to Delhi's population, which had a little over as 8 lakh people in 1951. Most of these migrants were from Punjab. They stayed in camps, schools, military barracks and gardens, hoping to build new homes. Some got the opportunity to occupy residences that had been vacated. Others were housed in refugee colonies. New colonies such as Lajpat Nagar and Tilak Nagar came up at this time. Shops and stalls were set up to cater to the demands of the migrants. Schools and colleges were also opened. So such things were going on. Even the skills and occupations of the refugees were quite different from those of the people they replaced. Many of the Muslims who went to Pakistan were artisans, petty traders and laborers. The new migrants coming to Delhi were rural landlords, lawyers, teachers, traders and small shopkeepers. Partition changed their lives and their occupations. They had to take up new jobs as hawkers, vendors, carpenters and ironsmiths. Many, however, prospered in the new business. So many people changed their occupation, many have left, some were very prosperous, some were not. So the large migration from Punjab changed the social milieu of Delhi. An urban culture largely based on Urdu was overshadowed by new taste and sensibilities in food, dress and the arts. Now inside the old city, what happened in the old city? See, meanwhile, what happened to the old city that had been Shahjahanabad? In the past, Mughal Delhi framed canals had brought not only fresh drinking water. So they not only brought fresh drinking water to homes, but also water for domestic uses. So this excellent system of water supply and drainage was neglected in the 19th century. The system of wells or the bowlies were also broken down. And channels to remove household waste called effluents were damaged. So this was at a time that the population of the city was continuously growing. The broken down canals could not serve the needs of this rapidly increasing population. So at the end of the 19th century, the Shahjahani drains were closed and a new system of open surface drains were introduced. So this system too was soon overburdened, and many of the wealthier inhabitants complained about the stench from the roadside freeways and overflowing open drains. So this entire drainage system was under a very bad condition. So the Delhi Municipal Committee was unwilling to spend money on a good drainage system. So at the same time, through millions of rupees were being spent on drainage systems in the New Delhi area, even same at the same time, a lot of decline was happening. So, a decline of Havelis. Now, Havelis are vacant. The Mughal aristocracy in the 17th and the 18th centuries lived in a very grand mansions called Havelis. A map of the mid-19th century showed at least 100 such Havelis, which were large walled compounds with mansions, courtyards and fountains. A Haveli housed many families at the time, and entering a Haveli through a beautiful gateway, you reached an open courtyard surrounded by public rooms meant for visitors and business, used exclusively by maids. The inner courtyard with its pavilions and the rooms were meant for women of the household. Rooms in the Havelis had multiple uses and a very little way of furniture. Even in the mid-19th century, Qamar al-Din Khan's Haveli had several structures within it. So this included housing for the car drivers, tent pitchers, torch bearers and a well for accountants, clerks and household servants. So this was how it was happening. So many of the Mughal Amirs, Amirs are the noblemen, okay, were unable to maintain this large establishment under conditions of British rule. So these people who were the owners of these Havelis, they could not sustain for long in this British era. So Havelis therefore began to be subdivided and sold. Often the street from front of the Havelis became shops or warehouses. Some Havelis were taken over by the upcoming mercantile class, but many fell into the decay and disuse. The colonial bungalow was quite different from the Havelis. Meant for a nuclear family, it was a large single-storied structure with a pitched roof and usually set in 1 or 2 acres of open ground. It had a separate living and dining rooms and bedrooms and a wide veranda. So that was how this British people had their homes being built. Okay. Running in the front and sometimes on the three sides, kitchens, tables and servants' quarters were in a separate space from the main house. The house was run by dozens of servants, and women of the household often sat on the verandas to supervise tailors or other tradesmen. So that was what the British household. The municipality begins to plan. The census of 1931 revealed that the walled city area was horribly crowded, with as many as 90 persons per acre. So while New Delhi had only about 3 persons per acre. The poor conditions of the walled city, however, did not stop it from expanding. In 1888, an extension scheme called Lahore Gate Improvement Scheme was planned by Robert Clegg for the walled city residents. The idea was to draw residents away from the old city to a new type of market square, around which shops would build. Streets in this redevelopment strictly followed the grid pattern and were of identical width, size and character. So this was the new type of buildings being taking place, the new market, how they were supposed to be, the new pattern, the new construction was going on. Land was divided into regular areas for the construction of neighborhoods. Clarke Ganj was the development was called. Remained incomplete and did not help to decongest the old city. Even in 1912, water supply and drainage in these new localities were very poor. The Delhi Improvement Trust was set up in 1936 and it built areas like Daryaganj South for wealthy Indians. Houses were grouped around parks within the houses. Space was divided according to new rules of privacy. Instead of spaces being shared by many families or groups, now different members of the same family had their own private spaces within the time. So this was a new going on. The herd baker in South Africa. So that is where actually your chapter completes. So now the herd baker in South Africa. The herd baker is the same person who has built the new city of Delhi at the time, the new architect. So in the early 1890s, a young English architect named Herd Baker went to South Africa in search of work. It was in South Africa that Baker came in touch with Cyril Rhodes, the governor of Cape Town, who inspired in Baker a love for the British Empire and admiration for the architectural heritage of ancient Roman Greece. So this figure, 17, shows the Union Building that Baker designed in the city of Pretoria in South Africa. So that's the same picture which you can see. It used some of the elements of the ancient classical architecture Baker later included in his plans in the Secretariat Building in New Delhi. The Union Building also located at a steep hill as the Secretariat Building in New Delhi. Have you noticed that people in the positions of power want to look down on others above them the upwards? That is why these buildings are very tall. They want to look down on the people in the Union Building and the Secretariat, both in the Imperial offices. You will understand that. So now let's see your true or false. True or false, we have fifth one. fifth one is already done. True or false is done. Filling the blanks. Fourth, filling the blanks. In 1888, an extension scheme called this was divided. That has to be done. Three and fourth we have done in the previous class. Question three and fourth. Even question number sixth is completed. So you will write for today's question number seventh and question number eight. For that much. Okay, question seventh and question eight for today, and fourth fill up. That's it for today. So we have finished our term one syllabus for history. Okay, please keep completing your notebooks till the time. Thank you, class.